Okay, can we start? So, today we will complete a bit the path to see how to decompose in spherical in tensor harmonics the gravitational perturbations. Actually, I will give you the basis for both vector and tensor harmonics. And we won't develop the calculation at the blackboard, because I don't think it's really, really useful. I mean, it's just there is a standard way to do these things, and we'll just lose time. And but I will give you, and probably we'll comment this or at the end of the lesson, or I will subtract some minutes this afternoon before the exercise. But the thing is that at the end, I mean, I will give you this file, okay, which contains all the ingredients to compute both. We will see what axial and polar perturbation means of Schwarzschild black hole. And the idea is that, there are different passages, and I mean, I will explain you how to derive. At the end of the story, we will come up with the, this is source, so you don't see it, with the master equation, the wave equation that we have seen yesterday, okay? And I will give you also this file in the most general case with the source that you can specify. So at the end, you will have the complete tool to do any kind of perturbation you want. The exercise today, I think, is particularly important and useful. Even if you don't complete today, I would suggest you to do this, because this exercise that you're gonna find in the PDF just completes everything. So the goal of the exercise is just to reproduce this curve here. So in the supplementary material that give you with the exercise, you will also find some data for this light blue curve. And this is the energy spectrum computed by a famous paper of Davis and Ruffini. Okay, and this is the energy spectrum of an infouling of a particle which is radially infouling from infinity with zero velocity to a Schwarzschild black hole. Okay, and this is the energy emitted. Okay, for unit frequency. And the goal is that through the all the techniques that you are developing during this day and integrating the master equation, you will be able to reproduce these dots, yellow dots here, okay, in order to get the same curve. And at the end, you will also be able, hopefully, to get this, okay, which is the waveform. So I strongly suggest to do this exercise. I mean, this is what you're looking here is the solution, so I will close it. But because if you do this, you will more or less at least you will have closed all the procedure. Okay, so the thing that we want to do now is just to generalize a bit the procedure that we have done yesterday for the scalar field. And itself is not too complex, it's just, a bit of indices. And it just consists to generalize, so we have this basic block of our decomposition, which is the spherical harmonics, and we need to generalize this thing in order to be able to decompose vector and tensor fields, okay? So, I have my coordinate. Let's assume I have my coordinate in manifold, and let me split in this. Two parts. So I have the small Latin letter, which corresponds to T and R. And I have the capital letter, which correspond to the angular variable theta and phi. And I will define the metric on the two sphere with the and of course this is well we already seen this. Just to recall you, and for this we define the metric tensor on the two sphere, which is this one. Okay. So now this is going to be one of the basic ingredients that we'll need to promote the spherical harmonics to higher level. Then we will also have to consider Levi-Civita tensor. Okay, on the theta phi space. And so first, I recall you that the Levi-Civita symbol is given by this sign here, by this matrix here, okay? Remember that the Levi-Civita symbol is always zero when the two indices are equal, and then is when you have even perturbation. I mean, you have epsilon 1, 2 is equal to 1, and then when you permute this, you get a minus sign here in this case. Now, as it is, this is not a tensor. Okay, this is actually called a tensor density. Actually, there is a nice rule that essentially, if you compute, you make a transformation of coordinate for this guy, you will find let it transform in this way, okay? So this guy here, the Levitin-Civitan symbol, transform as the Jacobian of the transformation multiplied by the sign, okay? Every time that you have this kind of transform identity here, this is not a tensor, but it's called an a tensor density. However, there is a very general rule to promote this guy here to a tensor, and in particular, which is to we say that this is a tensor density with weight, particular weight, which is given by the powers of J here. Okay, for example, this is a tensor density of weight 1. Okay, and in order to just promote this to a standard tensor, you just multiply this guy here by the square root of the determinant of your metric tensor here, okay? So essentially what you can do is that you can define this one
how that sin rho j Kim I didn't get that. Yeah,
this one. Well, if you do all the product with this, you will find that it depends on the sign of J.
So Jacobian is the del Z, del Z A.
Jacobian, this is just the determinant of the Jacobian of the transformation. You really, if you do this product here, taking into account this matrix here, you will find this thing. Okay. Yeah, for example, well, just if you take the lower in the higher indices, this will go like this. J to minus 1. So this is, for example, a tensor density of weight minus 1. Okay. In any case, so we will need also this guy here. I will actually now consider this is a tensor, so I will remove the bar because I don't need anymore. So let me consider this directly, this guy here. So we don't need any more, and this is going to be another thing that we're going to use to promote spherical harmonics to tensor and vector components. So we have this one here, and then we need another guy, okay? And which actually, the only geometric guy that we can have in practice is the covariant derivative, okay, on this spacetime here, okay? Applying covariant derivative, I mean, you already see, for example, that you apply this guy here to, if you just do this, you have a vector. Okay, so you're already promoting the scalar, the spherical harmonic to something which is a vector. Okay. Now, spherical harmonics are just eigenvectors of the Laplacian here that I've written in terms of the metric gamma alpha beta. And we will follow the derivation of that was in the paper by Reggie Wheeler and Bainzerilli, okay, for this, when in order to decompose the tensor perturbation, they just realized that the 10 components of the symmetric metric tensor just transform okay, so the property of the transformation of the component of the metric tensor for all of these strings. So you have three scalars corresponding to values of h, a, b. This is small b, so this a, b corresponds to t and r. Okay, then you have two vectors, okay, which correspond to a and b capital, so theta and phi. And then you have a second rank tensor, okay, which is completely given by just the angular variables here. Okay. You can find a more deep description on this. There is actually a previous paper, the famous paper by Zerilli with the perturbation of an infalling particle, but there is a previous paper, it's a bit more mathematical, that explain you all the in detail all the properties. Probably I'll give you the reference later on. Now, the things that we can do is that we can expand. So you already see now that we can take all the components of the metric tensor, and what we can do is expand them in terms of scalar vectors and tensor harmonics, okay? So we already have these. More or less, you know that we can build this thing here. We just need to construct these things here. But there is another ingredient that we need to understand, which are the transformation properties of this guy here, okay, with an operator, which is the parity operator. Parity. Okay. Which transform okay, this is a total reflection of both the direction of the axis of your reference system. Okay, and in particular, if you apply this find this relation here. But this is everywhere, from Wikipedia to standard textbooks. Okay. Now, the game is that when you look at this guy here, you can decompose your, you can actually have tensor and vector harmonics that have the same, these same properties, okay? And in this case, we will call it even transformation. So they have the same parity, okay, of spherical harmonics, or the opposite parity. And in the case, we'll talk about polar perturbation. This was the two names that you saw in the Mathematica file. Okay, so same parity. So we call even, or okay, and you will find, well, actually, this is just two names, but there is also magnetic and electric type of perturbation. I mean, there are at least three ways to call this thing here, but probably the most used notation is even polar or odd on axial perturbation, okay? Probably tomorrow, this morning, I will show you how to compute this thing here, okay? How to derive the Regge-Wheeler equation, okay? And this is, in general, way more complex because we will see we have more variable. Still, you will have this in the mathematical lot, but we lose a lot of time. I mean, probably, I will have also, maybe, I was discussing with some people that even Saturday, if we have more time, we can also just work half an hour and now to show you how to construct all these things, okay? Now, I can just give you let's construct, or at least I'll give you the form of the tensor and vector harmonics. Okay. So first, the vector part, okay? So I have the polar vector. And this is case is very, very simple. I'll call them with this index here. And it's by these guys here. Okay? Then I have the axial vector. I'll call S. And actually, you already see that every time that there is like the levitatività tensor, I mean, you get a minus in your transformation. This is more or less the standard rule. So this is why they transform with the opposite sign. Okay. And if you, if you insert just, I mean, if you make this computation explicitly, okay, you will find that you get components here. Actually, one over. That are given by these two terms here. Okay, so this already closed the polar the vector part. Okay, so we have scalar harmonics, and now we have vector ones, which are given by these two parts. Okay, the polar, which is just given by theta and phi, the derivative of theta and phi. Okay, and then we have the axial part, which is given by this. It's not. Yeah. Yeah, this just corresponds. I mean, if you take the axis and you just make the inversion of both the axes. Yeah, yeah. Well, I don't remember now if you change just if you want to make pi plus theta. Well, no, in general, I think that, I don't remember exactly how they transform, but I mean, for this inversion here, yes, for sure. For the others, actually, I think that we have to see case by case. I don't think that there is a general. Yeah, this is going to depend on the particular, if I remember correctly. I mean, this is something that we can also check, actually, really writing, but this is the important one. Given this, we have the polar, so this was the axial vector, this was the polar vector, now we have the polar tensor. And I'll call it, and again, now you have for the polar, I mean, knowing that you have to respect that particular symmetry here, what you can do, you can use or two derivatives, because you need two indices, okay? So you can need or two covariant derivatives, or the only other object that we have, the simplest one that we have with two indices is like the metric. Okay, so this is very, very easy to construct, because this is just given, well, for reasons of orthogonality and so on. It's given by this object here. Okay, this prefactor goes for normalization and whatever. So you have the double derivative here and the metric that I was writing before, okay? You see, now this is a tensor because we have two indices, two rank tensor here. Okay? And actually, I can also give you the explicit form of this, which is a bit more. Well, I will show you in the mathematical file, I mean, how these things behave. And these are just other combination of sine and tide and cos, which is useless to put here. And finally, we have the axial sector. Okay. And axial tensor. Which I call S, slightly a bit more complex. Which are given by this one, okay? And these are just combination of the previous vector axial harmonics, okay? Actually, let me give you, yeah, directly this matrix. So this is zeta, so it's just the standard way to call these harmonics is this one. So if you find some paper, you will find that they are defined in this way. And this is 1 over 2 Okay, we have to introduce other two objects just because otherwise the expression will be too long, which are this W and this X. But again, this will nothing be that other transformation, I mean, other algebraic manipulation of the spherical harmonics. And in particular, what we get is that X is just a bit long, but these are the other components, okay? So at the end, in principle, we have everything. We are just taking the metric, and we have decomposed the metric in irreducible representation. Representation of SO2. And we get these fundamental blocks, polar vector, axial vector, okay? And then we have the tensor, axial, and polar components. Everything, as you see, is just defined in terms, so you can do all the arrangements that you want, but at the end, the basic block will be the spherical harmonics, okay? And the procedure in this case will be always the same, okay? So you have a spherical background, and since the background is spherical, okay, you assume that your perturbation will be invariant under rotation, you can expand these in tensor harmonics. And you can do, I mean, this applies in general, okay? Whatever you, which is the background, whatever is the background that you have. It's gonna be a black hole, or if you want to perturb a boson stars or whatever. The things that are gonna change is that, and this depends on the part, actually, the theory of gravity that we are considering, is that, how we will see, we can simplify a bit the formalism by choosing a particular gauge transformation, okay? And that will reduce the degrees of freedom, will simplify a lot, especially the axial part. Of course, I mean, you can do something of this in GR, but in other theories, I mean, the choice is, for example, less. If you take massive gravity, for example, you cannot do the same choice that you make in GR, okay? You don't have the same freedom. So, okay, I will just write probably a couple of these. So the basic idea is that you take this object here, and you can combine them in order to get some basis in the tensor, for tensor harmonics. And with these, you can expand all tensor that you want. Okay, for example, in the second exercise, there was this the stress energy tensor decomposed in a basis of tensor harmonics. And actually, the basis of tensor harmonics was constructed starting by this, okay? There is like a more or less a general nomenclature, but for example, you can construct a basis which is given by this guy. This is a 4-4-4 matrix, and I mean, this is just to be a bit more shorter. This means that there is only one component which is different from zero, and the other one are all zero. Okay. Then I have this guy here. I have A, what I call ALM1, okay? And this is just a transpose of this object here. And what I have, I'll show just this last one and then we'll stop because it's not really. For example, that is made with vector harmonics. However, just to say that in general, okay, when you will, as we have seen for the stress energy tensor, you can take the tensor, okay, T, and you can expand the tensor as a sum of some coefficients that will depend on the basis, okay? This is, I mean, it's really a geometrical representation of everything, okay? We have the tensor basis, and we have the coefficient of the particular basis here that actually we will see how to compute it, and I also give you a simple instruction in the exercise that I show you last time. So there are tens of these, okay? Because, I mean, we need, in order to decompose all the ingredients, we need 10 basis vector, and this is just a normalization factor here, and you will see then in the Mathematica, I mean, in the Mathematica file, I'll give you all the matrix expression with this, so we don't need to deal with the blackboard, and you will immediately have them with all the properties, okay? Now, given, well, actually, in order to compute this coefficient here, we need to define a scalar product on the tensor harmonics as we have a scalar product on the spherical harmonics, okay? In general, when you have something as a overposition of spherical harmonics, in order to extract the coefficient, you make a scalar product on the conjugate of the scalar, and you integrate and use the orthogonality property of the spherical harmonics. Here you can do exactly the same because if these F and G are two spherical harmonics, we know that we can define the scalar product like this. We can introduce the scalar product between two vector objects. And of course, we will use the metric. Okay. And we will also introduce should be like this, okay? So we can just generalize the scalar product and in terms of the inverse of the metric. So, for example, if you want to extract this guy here, the things that you have to do is compute this guy here. And so on and so forth. This was actually one of the exercises that I gave you. I mean, this is very, very simple. It's just product of matrices there, and then integration. Actually, if you put here the expression for the vector harmonics, I can give you the normalization, because you remember that when you have these, the normalization will be this guy here. When you have two tensor harmonic, the normalization will just give by L times L plus 1. And then for the tensor harmonics, we'll have where we have that this n is given by this coefficient. Now, if you want to play, take a couple of tensor harmonics that we have defined before, you put into the scalar product, and you will find integrating that they should obey to this rule here. Okay? Now, the point is that if you take, this is a matrix representation that you will also see in the Mathematica file, but essentially, if you use this matrix representation to decompose our metric perturbation, okay, so we'll assume that we have a metric which is given by a background plus a perturbation, okay, and we can write the perturbation there in this way. It's exactly equivalent. So we have the scalar part, which of course depends only on the spherical harmonics. So it's run on the index t and r, okay? So we have t of r, and then we have the spherical harmonics. Then we have the vector part, the one that transforms as vectors. So we have two vectors. And so there is the polar part, and which is the one with the, have the same parity of the spherical harmonics. You remember this is just the derivative of y. And then we have the axial part. Okay, and finally, AB. We have the tensor part, okay?
For any general perturbation before finding the expanding the basis, like for example...
No, this will be completely general. I mean, this is completely general, okay? But so...
I mean, we
the idea is that, okay, you have, can you stop 1 second here? No. Okay, just 1 centimeter. Okay, it's okay. Here it's okay. You can. It's too late. Okay. Only one direct. So, idea is that, I mean, you have this thing here, okay? Let's assume that the most brute force approach that you can do. So, you have this guy here, which is a general decomposition of the metric perturbation of a spherically symmetric background, okay? You have your field equations. Be vacuum or whatever you want. And you put these into your field equations, okay? And the game will be to solve your field equation in order to find the form of the unknown components which depends on TNR. Okay? So now we can... So just before it goes completely down, that I mean we have the tensor part here with the polar part and then the axial sector here. Okay, just I'll show you in a minute. Here you don't see a lot. There are some coefficients that were here that I've just reabsorbed in definition of K, G, H, A, because they are not are really needed. So I'll just show just in a second what I mean. Okay, so this is, in Mathematica, for example, the general expression for your spherical harmonics, tensor harmonics, okay? This is actually taken by this paper by Sago of 2003, because the original paper by Zerilli, I mean, there are a lot of typos, I mean, but at that time you have to compute everything manually. I'm not able to do that blackboard, I cannot imagine, just to develop everything. So this is the general, I mean, these guys here, are the matrix that I was writing before. For example, this B0 will be given by this. Okay? You can do, so at the end, for example, you will have the axial part, which is will be given by this part here. Well, I will show why it takes this form, but at the end, this is just a combination of all the axial bases that I was going to write below, okay? Then what you do, in principle you do, is you take this guy here, okay? You put, and we will see later on, you'll put this in your Einstein equation, works for black hole in vacuum, okay? And so you will have a set of differential equations for all your unknown variables. So far, we have 10 unknown variables. You assume that the background is known, okay? So for example, if the G00 is completely specified, okay? And then you just solve this equation here as for this variable, okay? And the form of this variable will be dictated by the particular problem that you are solving. But this is particular, completely general. I mean, these are almost published, so I can give you a notebook who does this thing in massive gravity, okay? So, and the starting point is exactly the same. The form of the equation changes. And then, I mean, this will give a different form of the coefficients there. But the procedure at the beginning is exactly the same, except that actually the element in this matrix will change a bit because, I mean, we will use different gauge condition and I will show how, okay? Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Okay, I can close it and we'll see later. Well, actually, you can do this also on axially symmetric bag. For example, if you take a slowly rotating object, you can do perturbation also on this, using this approach here. The properties of, well, the nice feature of the spherical background is, since it's spherical, I mean, you will have that the axial and the polar part will not couple together, okay? So this is extremely, is very nice because it will simplify a lot. So if you have a spherically symmetric background, you can really, you don't need to solve the Einstein equation putting together both the polar and the axial part, okay? If you are 100, well, do this once in your life and then never again, but if you're sure that everything is correct, then you can compute this thing. If you are interested only in the axial part, you can just put, yeah, the axial decomposition, because at the end, if the procedure is correct, due to the spherical symmetry of the background, you will have just a set of equations for the axial part and a set of equations for the polar part. Yeah, I mean, well, actually, let's say that these do belong always to the same class, indeed, I think. For example, the method that I showed you yesterday with the continued fraction comes just because, Lieber realized that, I mean, it was starting, I think, from the Kerr solution, and it was realized that, I mean, it was just another form of a spheroidal equation. So they just belong to the same family.
So ultimately, doing these slowly rotating perturbations will give you the same expression as spheroidal harmonics, is what you're saying.
Say again?
if we are doing the slowly rotating case and we perturb it using continued fractions, you'd end up with the same equivalent expression as you would with spheroidal harmonics.
No, the continuous fraction is a method to solve to get a solution of the equation. What I'm just telling you is that in the original, well, Lever solved that problem to continued fraction because he realized that, the Tarkovsky equation for the Kerr perturbation actually it was a particular case of a spheroidal equation.
Okay.
So, in any case, this afternoon we'll spend a bit of time in working in this and separating the equation and so on and so forth. Okay, the things that I want to do. Okay, now let's count a bit the degree of freedoms that we have here, because we have three components here. Okay, given by TR and TR, then we have 1, 2, 3 component here, and then we have 4 component here. So in total 10 degrees of freedom. Okay. Now, the thing that we can do actually, and I think that this is something that you have already seen, is that we can simplify the problem. Okay. And simplify the problem means, in this case, to make a gauge transformation. Okay. On the variable on the H, on the perturbation here. Okay, this is the same that, for example, I think you have done when you have to the wave equation starting from perturbing the Minkowski spacetime. So I mean, you run up all the maths. At some point, you have an expression that it doesn't look like a wave equation. So box H something equal to something, where box in that case is given by the Laplacian in the flat spacetime. Okay. And what you do is just introduce a transformation on coordinate, and you make a gauge transformation on H, which means that essentially you consider a transformation with a vector xi, which is of the same order of H. Okay, you make a gauge transformation on H, and you simplify all everything in order to have box H equal to zero. Okay, here you can find exactly the same, except that now the metric will transform with the covariant derivative. Well, this delta mu and delta nu here is the covariant derivative made with respect to the background metric. Okay, because we need to, so we are assuming that this xi here is of the same order of H, so we are essentially neglecting all terms which are everything which is like this, I mean, can be neglected. Okay. Now, I won't make it too long because, I mean, the you can find actually a discussion on this into the Book of Majore. There's a very long and pedagogical discussion about this. But well, there is something that I can tell you more. So this is a vector. Okay. So, just on the light of everything that I've performed so far, something that I can do in order to find my gauge transformation, okay, is what? Just take this vector and spherically decompose it, in particularly using the vector harmonics. Okay, and at the end, what I will have, so I can define, again, since the vector obeys to axial, and we have two sectors, so the axial and the polar one, I can define So an axial component for this vector, okay, and here, well, maybe I cancel, but you can recognize like the axial vector harmonics, okay, the one that contains the derivatives of the spherical harmonics. And this function lambda depends on T and R, okay, and this is a function that has to be determined. And you can determine this function here in order to simplify your problem here. And then you have the polar part. That will be which is given by this expansion here. Okay, and there are the spherical harmonics here, and then there are the derivatives here, and we have other functions, which are one, two, and three functions here. Okay, they have to be determined. So you see, we have the general expression here, which contains 10 degrees of freedom. Okay, we are making a gauge transformation for simplifying the problem, and we have one function to determine here for the axial part, one, and one, two, three components from the polar part. Okay? So we can choose our gauge. Well, the transformation is also not unique, so there is the one that Reggie will have chosen, but there is another one. Okay? I mean, there are different ones that you, this is probably the one that simplify, or at least so far, most the equation. But the game is that we have and find the three we can actually find gauge transformation that kills three components and one axial component. Okay, so that will reduce the degrees of freedom of our problem. Now there is a well, essentially what you have to do is just take this the form of the vector expansion here, put here, compute all the covariant derivative, and then you have the metric in the two system, and you can find the transformation. And the choice made by what we call the Reggie-Wheeler gauge, okay, is to kill this guy here, kill this guy here, and kill this guy here. Is it correct? G, yeah, it should be. No, sorry, not this one. Kill this component here. So the axial part. So the so H, it should be, yeah, this one is killed. This one, yes, or no, wait a second, one, two, three, no, okay, sorry, I was making confusion. Okay, so the choice by Reggie Wheeler is to kill this guy here, and this one. Yeah. Well, just looking at the properties transformation of this object here in terms of the parity. And looking at the transformation property of these guys in terms of the parity operator and in the form of spherical harmonics. It's particularly complex. I mean, I can show you later, but it's... the idea is that you kill one term here, which is one polar, two terms here, which are two polars, So you have essentially run out of choice for the polar component, because you have three, and one axial part, because you only have one axial. No, no, this one are independent. No, 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 why? No. You have three functions here that you have to choose, and then one function here. And with those, you can kill one, two, three, and one. So at the end, you have three, then you have two here, and then you have one component here. Okay? So at the end of the game, you only left with this perturbation H, which will be given by this is going to be the axial part. And this means that it's just a transponder of the function. And I just called the axial function to be consistent with, I mean, most of the nomenclature literature. So you have only two functions to determine, which are H0 and H1 for the axial part, okay? Because originally we had three components, but we have reduced them. And then there is, well, I can cancel it because probably don't need anymore. Can I cancel it? We'll have this expression for the polar part, okay? And most of the, well, you can do or you cannot, but I mean, there are a lot of works in which it choose the normalization of H2 and H0 in order to incorporate the factor of FOR. This is the factor which is in front of GTT of the background, I mean, the GTT zero. Okay, for Schwarz, this is just -1, -2 mRR with the minus in front, okay? This is just to make, so you can immediately compare the effect of the perturbation with respect to the magnitude of the the background, okay? So you already see that here we have 1, 2, 3, 4 functions, okay? And only two there. So in general, solving the problem for the polar perturbation will be much more difficult. I mean, in the sense that it is more involved. You need more equations to determine these things, and the procedure will be a bit longer. And this will lead to the Zerilli equation, while this thing here will lead to the Regge-Wheeler equation. Of course, there are theories that you cannot do this. There are, for example, in other theories of gravity, if you want black holes, so. And the transformation is not unique, but this is particular. For the axial part, this is really, really super useful because it's the axial part, I mean, we cannot do, I don't want to do this, but the axial part can almost be done on the blackboard. It's very, very easy to do. And we will see it. So, okay. Let me... I'll use the last minutes then too. So at the end, you are left with these two matrices, which correspond to your perturbation. You take your code, you put inside them, you run the Einstein equation, and you solve your problems. This means that, sometimes you can find, in some easy problem, but I mean, you solve in terms of H0, A1, or your unknown variable, okay? Actually, in the most physical scenario, what you get is that your Einstein equations are actually sourced. Okay? So you have... you have sourced by some kind of stress-energy tensor here. Okay? And the simplest case, and actually the one that, for example, correspond to the exercise that you're going to make today, is when you have a particle on a geodesic of the background. Okay? You have the stress-energy tensor of a particle, okay? And you want to compute the effect of this particle that acts as a perturbation on the background here. Now, essentially, what have we done so far, we have seen it from the left-hand side of this equation. Of course, if you expand in tensor harmonic this guy here, you have to expand in tensor harmonic also this guy here, which was the trace of the second exercise that I gave you, okay? But this is very, very easy, because you can, as I told you, you can write this T as the sum over L and M, all the components of the basis that I showed you before, okay? The only things that you have to do is to identify the form of the coefficients that were here, okay? And in order to do, you have to write the explicit form of T, okay? We'll just write one expression. So, this is the... Actually, let me write with upper index. So let's assume that we have a particle moving on a geodesic zeta of mu with u mu, which is the four velocity of the particle, of the test particle, in the coordinate tr, theta, and phi. So actually, we can immediately we can write this object in this way in order to remove the delta on time, and in the end, we will leave with this guy here. I will directly write. With this expression here. So M0 is the... there is probably also a gamma here. So M0 is the particle, that's the mass of the test particle. Then there is like the boost factor coming from there. There are dz in dt, which come from here, where I change just the variable. And then there is this r square sin theta, which comes from the determinant here. And then I have three delta, which are pointed to the location of the particle and the angular variable of the particle here, where I've just eliminated the theta component by the time component by integrating the stress energy tensor there. Okay? And actually, we can write this thing. using the properties of the delta, we can just write this in this way, eliminating the sin theta factor. Okay? But this is just standard. So now, this is the form of your metric of the your stress energy tensor. Okay? This is general form in the time domain. What you have to do in order to identify the particular form of the coefficient A of B, where small a and small b are one of the basis tensors that we have seen before, you just act, take the stress energy tensor here, and use the scalar product between two tensors that we have seen before. G alpha. Okay. And make this integral here, which is also particularly simple because, I mean, there are delta on the angular variables. There is an integral there on the angular variable. So it's very, very simple to obtain. I mean, you can do this with pen and paper. Now, and this actually was one of the exercises, so I won't compute anything, any one of these, because this is particularly simple. There are, in general, two specific cases that can be useful, okay, to understand just the physics properties of the problem of the excitations of these modes due to a particle which is moving on a geodesics, and where, so the form, the explicit form of this guy here will depend on this particular orbital configuration that we are considering. Two common cases which are particularly simple are the circular case, and the radial in falling case. Okay? So in the first case, you have like a particle which is on the background is partial, it's on equatorial orbit of the background. The other case in which you have like a particle which is radially falling into the black hole. For example, the exercise that I give you, corresponding to reproduce the data by Davis and Ruffini, correspond to this particular case with a particle which is in falling with zero velocity from infinity into the black hole. Okay, you see the nice curve of the energy spectrum there. More or less that's all, because essentially what you do is just you project your stress energy tensor onto the spherical harmonics, okay, you find the coefficients, okay, and you will have essentially a set of equations with tensor decomposition of the metric component, tensor decomposition of the stress energy tensor, okay, so you will have, instead of homogeneous differential equation, you will have non-homogeneous differential equation, and you have to solve it, okay? Actually, how do you solve it? Using the green function approach that I showed you before, which is also the exercise, okay? So this is more or less close the circle, because we start looking at a general case in which we have a source equation, okay? And this is actually the case. If you take Einstein equation perturbed by an infolding or a particle into geodesics, okay, you will have that, for example, the axial component will act like this. Okay, I call this psi because there's a way to arrange the function of the axial perturbation in order to get the wave equation. Okay, where this source here will just depend on the coefficients that I showed you before. So this source here will depend on this. And I mean, the way we integrate this guy here is exactly that I showed you before, where there is the integral on the solution at the horizon multiplied by the source divided by the Bronsky and blah, blah, blah. The background is in the background there, and in the boundary conditions. No, you have, well, when you solve this thing here, you will show you before that there was, before yesterday and 2 days ago, that in order to solve this problem, you will have to solve, to impose a particular set of boundary conditions. The striking part of the black holes will come because the boundary condition assumes that there is an horizon. For now, yes. No, this is just to say that this is a scalar which is function of the components of the stressor. Sorry, how do we determine this S? I'll show you this afternoon. But actually, so the procedure that you use in the homogeneous case. So don't look at this, put a zero on this, you'll have the homogeneous case, which is the case in which you don't take the source, and I'll show you how to arrange in order to have the Regge-Willebrand equation. When you make this arrangement, at some point you will end up with some source term. Okay, I will show you this afternoon. Okay, now actually this afternoon I will show how to construct this, and there is also a particular simple way to simplify in the case of radial and circular orbit particle the form of the source sensor, and we will work out this afternoon. But since we have only 15 minutes, I think we can just summarize a bit of some of the properties of the that we've seen so far, because tomorrow in the last lesson we'll just talk about I will make a bit of phenomenology of the exotic compact object. So we will see, we'll analyze a bit this paper by Zimmermann and Mark about the echoes, and then I will show you some other tools that we can use in gravitational wave to distinguish regular black holes from exotic compact object. Okay. Actually, the static perturbation will lead to another interesting quantity that we'll talk about in the last afternoon tomorrow. Okay. So, some important facts about that we have seen so far. That given the boundary conditions, okay, one of the striking differences between the classical problem and the black hole perturbation theories are the boundary condition, okay? That in case of a black hole, we have outgoing, actually ingoing at the horizon. And outgoing at infinity. Okay, so differently from the string case, we have an intrinsic dissipative system, okay, which leaks energy at both the ends of the domain, both the edges of the domain. Okay, I'm asking no incoming radiation for infinity and nothing that can escape from the horizon here. Now, this is another way to see that the frequency of the quasi-normal modes are actually complex values. Okay, so the basic idea. Well, there are different ways to understand that to see before. I mean, all the analysis that what we're gonna expect from the quasi-normal modes are complex frequency. One of these is that we are imposing complex boundary condition to the problem. The other one is that if you look at this dependence here, okay, in the time space, we are asking that, I mean, at some point, our perturbation just goes away because it's absorbed by the horizon or goes away to infinity. We have to find something which goes to zero. So this thing here has to have an imaginary part. Okay. And actually, the imaginary part, at least with this convention here, has to be negative. Okay, so this guy here will kill our perturbation, because the perturbation has to fade away. And indeed, if you remember, for this part, this was the choice. With this particular choice, when you do the analysis in terms of the Green function, and you close the contour plot, the contour in the complex plane, you find that the frequency are in the negative complex plane. Okay, so this was just a bit of intuition that we should have come out with something like this, which has a complex nature. Okay, we can also compare what we found with the post-Newtonian approximation. Okay, and which is, I mean, the standard way, for example, to take all the gravitational wave emission by a two-body system. These are both the perturbative approach. Okay, but for example, in the post-Newtonian case, we make an expansion in powers of v over c. Okay. While in this case, I mean, we don't know any expansion. We can accept all values of V. Okay. The other difference is that we are limited in the field of small perturbation. So everything that, for example, I was telling you about the stress-energy tensor, which sources the equation, is okay as far as the stress-energy tensor is a small perturbation of the... It really acts like a geodesics. Okay. So, for example, you can have a supermassive black hole and a neutron star or a tensor masses. Well, whenever, I mean, the ratio between the two guys is very, very small, I mean, our things is reliable. While in this case, you can also extend it in order to include, I mean, a real two-body problem. This is what we generally use. There is an important feature, and this So, look at this guy here. And let me expand. And it's like this, right? But we saw that the imaginary part is negative, okay? For requiring, we saw, I mean, in the analysis and for that assumption there. So this is a negative term. Sorry? It's R star, sorry. So the point is that when R, and this is the outgoing boundary condition at infinity. The point is that when R star goes to infinity, this guy goes to infinity. And it's actually, this is also true in the other case. So if you take the case, the ingoing, and you see the limit for R star to minus infinity, you also see that the perturbation goes to infinity. So this is very, I mean, it's very weird, because you have a perturbation that spatially, it goes to infinity above the end of your domain. Okay, this is very, very problematic, because essentially at the end you have an infinite amount of energy. And this is actually why they are quasi-normal, they are also quite normal modes, because they cannot be treated as a complete set. There are different ways to see these, but actually, they have, essentially, the basic idea is that you cannot represent a state over all the domain with something that then goes to infinity at the end of the domain. This is not physically acceptable. So actually, the things that how we can interpret the quasi-normal modes, we have to look again to the imaginary part. So for example, in this case, we have these things here. Okay. We have to think a quasi-normal mode, so something that is localized at the particular values of the space, okay, which, and larger is the values of R, so more dangerous is the things because we are going to infinity, larger has to be the values of T in order the perturbation to be finite. Okay. Also, this is very, very problematic for the direct computation that I was showing yesterday. So in order to compute quasi-normal modes, there is this technique that I show you that is the direct integration, essentially. That practically means that I'm looking when the ingoing amplitude at the horizon is zero. So I have like at infinity. So I have a wave that goes like this, okay? When you compute the Wronskian of the two solutions, actually the Wronskian is equal to A in, and for the quasi-normal mode, asking that the Wronskian is equal to zero means to ask that A in is equal to zero, which is physically compatible with all our problem, because we are asking that there is no ingoing from infinity. The problem is that this guy, this guy in here, okay, explodes for this reason. So it's extremely challenging to find numerically something which is very, very small into something which is extremely large. Okay? So sometimes the direct integration, especially for the high overtones, becomes a bit problematic, and that's where the continuous function methods becomes more powerful. I mean, this is just really a numerical problem. Okay, you have a large number here, and you have to dig in this large number in order to find something that eventually will go to zero mathematically. So it's very, very problematic. Okay. So quasi-normal modes is a phenomenon that for fixed R, okay? Larger values of R means larger value of T in order to make the perturbation finite. Okay, some numbers. For non-rotating objects, we have that the frequency of the fundamental mode, so we can write omega as 2 pi f. And also the damping time. That is given by this object here. Okay. So you see immediately the difference between the objects that are for the target of LIGO Virgo, for which we are going Mach. I mean, I think that LIGO cannot see anything with above like 10 to 3, 10 to 4 solar masses, so more or less. And what we have for LISA. Okay, there is this huge scale factor, and also about the damping times. Okay, these numbers here are particularly important for LISA, where the you know LISA, what is it? It's like this big satellite with, I don't remember anymore, if of 2 or 5 millions kilometers length. I mean, there are different proposals. And it's actually interferometry on the space here. But the problem is that, so in order to appreciate something with LISA, you have to require that your damping time is at least longer than the time that the light takes to go from one satellite to the other. Okay? So if you take, I have the number probably here for the old mission. Something like this. So this is the light, the time that the lights take to go from one of the device of LISA to go to the other one. Okay, it's just the path divided by the speed of light. So you have to require that your normal modes, in order to be seen by the detector, has to be at least a damping time comparable with this. Because if it's shorter, the signal will just fade out before appreciating this. Okay. Ah, only 1 minute. And in general, when we also add rotation, the damping times increase. So for example, for rotation, we have for the mode 2 to 0, This is L, M, and N. We have something like this. So it's almost three times, well, more than two times what we have, okay? And this is for A, which is 0.98, where A is J divided by M squared, is the spin parameter of the black hole. What you have actually for when you introduce the rotation is something like this. So this is A equal to zero. And when you add the rotation, you split in different components. Okay, it's something that you also see, well, it's very similar to the, it's called Zeeman effect, okay, with the electric field. And more increase you the spin, more you go in direction, so you go far from the Schwarzschild case. Now, can I have all the other 2 minutes? Let's assume that you have done. Crushed. Your homework, and you have computed, like, you have solved the problem with the Regge-Wheeler equation, and you have computed the quasi-normal modes, okay? What you find is like this, for example, for the L equal 2 and the L equal 3 case, okay? And so this is the frequency here. Positive and negative frequency for the Schwarzschild case are just completely symmetric. Okay? And what you find here, essentially, this is with increasing over ton N. Okay. So you see how the frequency change between the L equal 2, L equal 3 modes. And actually, the fundamental one is the one which has the smallest damping time. Okay. And, well, the smallest omega, actually, which has the longest damping time. Okay. Which means the guy that live longer in your signal, so you can, well, arguably, if LIGO has seen something, is the mode with the smallest imaginary part, which corresponds to one with the longest damping time, which survives more, okay? You won't see anything which dies immediately. Here, there is a particular point in which, I mean, the frequency, the real part, is almost zero, okay? And these guys actually move out very, very soon with the multiple number L, okay? This more or less sets up the threshold for the high damping regime, okay? The threshold for the high damping regime. If you increase omega, the damping will be strong, okay? And actually, I think this is around N equal 9, and this is for like N equal 40 something. So it rapidly, sorry? This is N equal 9. No, it's going like this for N. Sorry? Is it on this right here? Yeah, because this is 2 omega N, so the omega for Schwarzschild is 0.37 in geometrical units, so it's something this because this is 0.7. And it becomes extremely difficult to extract this thing here with the increase because, I mean, you have to resolve something which is an overton all over order 40. Okay. Now, okay, I'll leave you. And I just want to tell you that let me put that plot in another way. It's exactly the same, just shifted. I think. Okay, let's write only the real part. So what you see is that the last damped mode is the one with the highest frequency. Okay. Then if you increase, this is with increasing n. If you increase n, the imaginary part increases, the negative, the real part decreases. It goes to zero at that point. That is, and then I mean, you get this flat thing here with the imaginary part of omega. This is very, very strange, especially if you compare anything that you see for like, normal like vibration in, solid state physics, or even for like the excitation of quantum states, okay? Because in general, for example, if you look like to normal vibrations, okay, you have that both the imaginary and the real part grows with the increasing overtone, okay? And the fact that, for example, in a solid, the imaginary part at the end just diverge is because since both omega of r and omega of I increase together, at some point, the wavelength of the perturbation, since this guy here is growing together in the real solid state physics, this becomes comparable with the size of the lattice. So essentially, your material cannot sustain anymore the perturbation. This is actually weird. If you look at this plot, it's also weird if you think in terms of quantum mechanics, because the high energy states, so the one with the largest values of the real frequency, are also the one which decay faster. Okay, so they have the largest values of omega, which is actually the opposite here. Okay. So there's really no way to find a correspondence, this guy here, so the black hole, with something that we have seen for quantum states. The physics, this is an example that you can find in the book of Maggiore. There is a very, very nice way to explain all these things if you try to explain the normal most of black hole in terms of a series of damped exponentials with some particular features. There are really too many things to do. I don't know if I will be able to explain. This is just in the book of Maggiore that you can see. This afternoon, maybe we look at this and also at the derivation of the Regge-Wheeler equation. Okay. But this is what I want to highlight is that this thing here is really, really something that we haven't seen in the normal behavior. Okay. The quantum physics is really the simplest comparison that you can have. All these high energy states decay faster. You don't see it here. So it's very, very anomalous. Okay, we can finish this afternoon. And so we can complete a bit of the theory this afternoon.